Well, next up, we are very lucky to have Dr. Jay Fawver join us. I'm advancing. Oh, I went too far. Can you guys go back? This is a clicker that doesn't go back. So Dr. Jay Fawver, he is the medical director of Mind Body Medicine, which is a division of Parkview Physicians Group. And there he orchestrates the treatment for over 7,000 people. That's amazing, with his very unique healthcare delivery model. Dr. Fawver was a pharmacist before he went to medical school, and that's what gives him his very unique perspectives on using personalized medicine, really, to deliver great care. So thank you for being here.
Okay. Thank you, Tammy. And good evening. My day job is with Mind Body Medicine, down at 14 and 69. I'm a psychiatrist and I have 10 nurse practitioners who work with me and a fantastic team of 13 support staff. Any of them here tonight? I told them there's gonna be lobster. Okay, I said there's gonna be lobster, so that's why you showed up. For the past 21 years, I've been the host of Matters of the Mind on PBS. They don't really know how to tell me to leave because I've been there longer than most of the PBS staff, so I keep showing up on Monday nights, so they keep me on. I had a letter over the past year to Matters of the Mind, and it read, "Dear Dr. Fawver, my teenage grandson has a severe temper, doesn't get along with others, and is very impulsive. However, I don't want him to be ostracized and teased by his friends and peers for getting mental health treatment. How do I keep his mental health problems and treatment private?" So how do you answer that? Here's how I answered it. I said, and this goes along with the stigma we talked about before, if your grandson has a severe temper, doesn't get along with others, and is very impulsive, it's likely that other people know that he has mental health problems. But Deborah McMahon mentioned the stigma earlier, and Christina just went over that great video talking about stigma. There's a stigma with mental health treatment, you know. So I'm going to talk about the precision that we're trying to use nowadays in trying to figure out the best treatment for each individual that we treat. And the title is Utilizing Pharmaceutical Precision, the Journey from Informative Guessing to Informative Decision Making. Did I come up with that title? You still showed up. So for the next 3 hours, I'm going to be able to present this information. Right? 30 minutes? I'll keep it down to 30 minutes. And then you get a break, fortunately. So why is mental health conditions, why are they different from other medical illnesses? Well, you know, why are less than 1% of the IU medical school graduates going into psychiatry? We have a different field. It's challenging in its own ways. We're unable to see the brain functioning. Now, with wind or electricity, you're unable to see the process of wind or electricity. You might say, well, I see the electricity in here tonight. No, you see the process. You see the actual effects of it itself. So you can't see the little electrons going through the wires and everything, but what you see will be the effects of electricity. Same with wind. You might say, well, I saw the wind out there tonight. I saw the flag waving in the wind. No, you saw the effects of the wind. You didn't see the actual wind itself. So when we treat mental health conditions, we can't see the brain functioning like our friends in cardiology or nephrology and pulmonology. They can actually see what's going on in the body. We can't see that. And every now and then you'll see an infomercial or you'll see something on a PBS special that I don't really agree with, talking about how you can scan the brain and tell everything about you. It doesn't work that way. The spec scans out there that they show, it's like watching a two-minute clip of a movie and interpreting what the movie's about. You just can't do that. It's not that easy. So with that being said, in mental health treatment, we're unable to see the impaired brain functioning itself, but what we are able to do is recognize the effects that we happen to call psychiatric symptoms. So with that in mind, what is a mental illness? Well, a mental illness itself, whether it's an adult, adolescent, child, has to have symptom clusters. And symptom clusters can be mood disturbances, anxiety disorders, psychotic disorders, ADHD or ADD, or memory disorders. You gotta have certain symptom clusters that are there. And those symptom clusters have to go on for a period of time. For instance, for bipolar disorder, it's gotta be 4 to 7 days. depression 2 weeks straight, and for anxiety disorders for a whole month. Schizophrenia, 6 months of symptoms give you chronic schizophrenia. So with schizophrenia, with bipolar disorder, with depression, with anxiety disturbances, you have to have a persistence of those symptoms. And then very important, very, very important, is you have to have impairment. You have to have impairment socially at school, if you're an adult, in your marriage, with your work. You've got to have impairment, and you will have difficulty with impairment due to concentration, memory, and reasoning. So with that being said, there's mental illnesses and there's quirks. For instance, how many of you in here tonight ate clockwise around your plate when you ate? Okay, that's kind of embarrassing. Well, I know this guy who always eats clockwise around his plate. Okay, it's me. That's a quirk. My staff would readily tell you I have a lot of quirks, all right? We get that. It's a quirk if it doesn't cause you impairment. It's a mental illness if somebody were to stop me from eating clockwise around my plate, and I threw my plate and turned the table over. Okay, that's a mental illness. It's a quirk if I just happen to prefer to start at the 1 o'clock position, it seems perfectly normal to me, and go around clockwise, and that's how you eat. So, too much information there. In the past 30 years, we've had a progression in how we treat people with medications. You know, back in the 80s, it was all trial and error, trial and error, trial and error. Then we started to get more personalized in terms of figuring out, okay, can we figure out which medications might work best for some people? And more recently, we have a little bit more precision with getting genetic testing, and that's going to be the focus of my presentation. So we use what's called a personalized algorithm for treatment at Mind Body Medicine. It's called the PAT. It's not point after touchdown. We don't spike the ball or anything. But after we assess somebody, these are the five features that we examine to determine which type of medication might do best for somebody. So, first off, we look at a systematic diagnostic assessment. We look at those symptom clusters, we look at the persistence for those symptom clusters, and we look for evidence of impairment. So we try to diagnose the best we can what a person's dealing with. Secondly, we look at their past psychiatric medication history, not just as a whole bunch and group. We categorize them based on mechanism of action, and we go a step further if we can. We want to know how long they were on the medication, what doses they were, and specifically, did they have good effects, bad effects, side effects, tolerability, did they work? I like to hear what percentage people can give me on how well the medications worked. Third, we look at the family history of treatment responses. Now, when you see an adolescent especially, adolescents might not have been on that many medications, but their family members have. It's very important for us to try to figure out and find out if their family members have had treatment responses, good or bad, with various medications. We saw an 18-year-old lady a few months ago, and she came in, and she had been on Lexapro over the recent past, and she wasn't doing very well. Simple question. I looked at her mother and asked, are you taking anything for depression or anxiety? She said, yeah, Zoloft, I'm doing great. Guess what? We changed her to Zoloft, and the girl did great. So sometimes it's that simple. You got to look at the family history of treatment response. Fourth, we look at the patient goals and side effects that they want to avoid. That sounds pretty simple, but you got to ask it. I'll often ask people, what are the three main goals you want to achieve? Sometimes I get kind of thrown off. I didn't expect them to say those three goals, but I want to personalize their treatment by looking at their treatment goals, and specifically, what side effects do they want to avoid? Now, some side effects people just want to avoid, like weight gain, or they don't want to have difficulty with wakefulness at night. So we have to look at those from a personalized standpoint. But the fifth dimension that we now can add with the systematic diagnostic assessment, past psychiatric medication history, family history of treatment responses, the treatment goals and side effects to be avoided, the fifth dimension for the PAT that we can now add will be genetic testing. And this is something relatively new. It's only been out for a past few years. At Mind Body Medicine, we've assessed people over the past 3 years with genetic testing, and we've seen about 3,000 people. We're just now doing a database analysis that we should be starting this next week. We have a conference call to talk about our results, and then we're going to go from there. So I'm going to talk about genetic testing in psychiatry, looking at the why, what, where, and how. So why do we do genetic testing? What is the testing? How is the sample collected? And where do we go from here? So let's start out with an analogy. Let's say you're driving down Highway 30 and your car breaks down, and pop the hood, you figure out that you have a clogged fuel filter. Now, if you've ever had a clogged fuel filter before, you press on the accelerator, car didn't go. So car just doesn't work with a clogged fuel filter. So you have a clogged fuel filter and you need to get a replacement part. You call up the mechanic, what's the first thing they're going to ask you? They're going to ask you, what's the make and model of your car? And they'll actually ask you what year it is, for that matter. What they're trying to do is give you the right part for the right fit, for the right make and model. Ford parts don't fit on Chevys. Toyota parts don't fit on Hondas. You have to get them the right year, the right make and model. You have to be precise in terms of knowing what part's going to fit. Well, in the case of depression, somebody says, I'm depressed, and you do a diagnostic assessment. Yep, it's not hypothyroidism, it's not anemia, it's depression. So they're depressed. Which antidepressant do we choose? You know, and for years, it's kind of like throwing a dart because we have a lot of different antidepressants from which to choose. I came out of my psychiatric training in 1987, and this brand new medication came out called Prozac at that time. Fluoxetine is the generic name, revolutionized our treatment because for the first time, we could treat people for depression and it didn't cause them sedation, lightheadedness, and weight gain, which was a horrible problem with a lot of other medications. Over the course of time, we've had a lot of medications from which to choose. As Dr. McMahon mentioned earlier, these medications affect serotonin, norepinephrine, dopamine. Which one do you go with? Well, we've tried to get ourselves to believe as psychiatrists that we can look at somebody's symptoms and just get a good feel for which antidepressant they need. Well, the research has shown that we're wrong a lot of the times when we try to do that. So that type of speculation on at matching symptoms with treatment response to antidepressants hasn't really worked out. So we have this study called the STAR-D trial. It involved over 3,600 patients, and it was published over 10 years ago. Step one on the STAR-D trial was where everybody got citalopram, Celexa, a commonly used antidepressant. All 3,671 patients got Celexa. 33% of them got well over the course of 3 months. Well, the next 3 months, step two, they took something else. Wellbutrin or another antidepressant or added on to something to Celexa, but they had a different treatment for 3 months. That's step two. Well, up to 57% of them got well. Step three is to look at the people who didn't get well and they were on something, other treatment. Then step four, another treatment. So it was 3 months, 3 months, 3 months, 3 months, and step one, two, three, and four. Over the course of a year, after four antidepressant trials, 33% of people remained unwell. That's not acceptable. And if you look at that first trial with citalopram, 33% of them got well with the first trial on an antidepressant. Now, if you're a baseball player like Joe DiMaggio, if you're successful one out of three times, you're in the Hall of Fame. Joe DiMaggio had a career batting average of .325, so he's in the Hall of Fame. As a psychiatrist, I don't think we need to be in the Hall of Fame if we're right one out of three times with our initial choices on antidepressants. So the question always is, what's the make and model of your brain? When we're treating somebody, we want to know what the hardware looks like in a person's brain. Everybody's different. Precision medicine is where we're trying to get the right medication and we can get pharmacodynamic genes. Pharmacodynamic genes are genes that tell you how well a medication is going to work. And then you have pharmacokinetic genes that give you the dosage that you ought to be using. Pharmacokinetic genes give you guidance whether you should use a high dosage, a usual dosage, or a low dosage for medications. So you look at the pharmacodynamic genes and you look at the pharmacokinetic genes. So I'm going to give you a little genetics 101 here. We have 23 pairs of chromosomes. Chromosomes are just long strands of DNA, all right? The DNA code was unraveled about 10 years ago. DNA consists of all these different nucleotide base pairs. Genes are little pieces on the DNA. And we have 23,000 different genes, all right? Now, here's what's interesting. 99.9% of those genes are all the same for us. That's what makes us humans. 0.1% of the genes are the ones we really need to look at. So 0.1% variance is what we're hearing about. So what we're trying to figure out, of that 0.1% of genes out there, which ones are doing what in terms of mechanisms of action, the pharmacodynamic standpoint, and what kind of effects they're giving us for the dosages that we need for medications. That's the pharmacokinetic. You get one gene from your mom, one gene from your dad, and you put them together and you look at those two genes. Well, you've got heterozygous genes, where like with the MTHR example here, CT instead of CC means heterozygous. The dopamine receptor gene type 2 is C delete, or rather than CC, that's heterozygous. Homozygous means you got the same gene from your mom, same gene from your dad. So that's homozygous. So that's kind of how we read those. They're called individual gene alleles. We use Genomind as a company that we use for the genetic testing. And again, we've tested 3,000 people in the past 3 years with Genomind. The pharmacodynamic genes, there's a bunch of them here. So you'll get these pharmacodynamic genes that tell you, hopefully predictably, how well a medication is going to work based on mechanism of action, matching it with that person. And then you have the pharmacokinetic genes. The pharmacokinetic genes tell you, do you need to use a high dosage for certain medications, a low dosage for certain medications, or the usual dosage? So that's kind of how we line up the genetic testing. Well, here's a wheel that we're kind of still refining at MindBody Medicine. In the green, you start with the serotonin transporter gene called the SLC6A4. And the SLC6A4 has an S allele, has an LG allele, or an LA allele. LA means you'd probably do well on citalopram or other popular medications like Prozac, Zoloft, Lexapro, and so forth. So if you're LA, we often go with an SSRI like those. But only about 1/4 of our patients in our practice are LA, which means that 3/4 of the people in our practice don't tend to respond really well to the traditional medications like Prozac, Lexapro, Zoloft, Celexa, and so forth. And that's exactly what we see. So, as clinically indicated, if they have these other gene abnormalities, or mutations as we would call them, we will go with other directions in treatment. And this list is always growing. I'll give you a few minutes to write all this down. But when you see those mutations there, it's giving our staff guidance on which direction to go. Now, my 10 nurse practitioners got a little apprehensive when they first saw this years ago, but they've got it down. It's in their brains. It's just like talking another language to them right now. So if you have we will talk about a person, and I got a text from one of my nurse practitioners a few years ago, and she said, I've got a patient here with an SLC6A4 LAS and COMT Val-Val. Do you think I should use Wellbutrin? And that's in the text message. And my response was, yes. But I thought that was interesting how that's how we communicate at our office. You know, somebody will be doing horribly on a medication like Cymbalta, and they'll be on the usual dosages of Cymbalta, common medication, and we'll ask, are they COMT Val-Val? And we'll just talk in code like that because the codes can predict which direction to go. So these are the different medications we might use based on what the code is telling us to use. And over the next few weeks, we're going to try to put more of that together based on our first 300 patients that we're studying. But it's been an interesting ride for us because it gives us that fifth dimension of treatment decision we would have never expected before. So, should we just do sampling on everybody in this room tonight and let's figure out which medications you need? Doesn't work that way. Doesn't work that way. I'd probably be on a lot of medications if I... Epigenetics. Epigenetics is how the environment affects your genes. You can have COMT Val-Val profile, which 1 out of 4 of you would have. 1 out of 4 of us have COMT Val-Val, which means that potentially the dopamine in the front part of your brain is getting chewed up real fast, like a little Pac-Man. Potentially, if you're COMT Val-Val, the dopamine in your front part of your brain is getting chewed up too much. So you'd want to take a medication that increases dopamine, like Wellbutrin, may be a stimulant, Trintellix, Pramipexol. These medications increase dopamine transmission if you had symptoms of depression or ADHD, for instance. But if you don't, you don't treat it. Epigenetics tells you the impact of the environment on the genes themselves. These genes have to be turned on or off inappropriately to have symptoms of mental illness. So just having the gene means nothing. Having the genes turned on and off is what gives you the symptoms. So if you come in and see us and you have symptoms of depression and you have COMT Val-Val, we might give you something like Wellbutrin or Trintellix. But if you don't have the symptoms, you don't treat it. You don't treat it any more than you'd wear somebody else's eyeglasses. If you have nice vision and you have good vision, you're not going to put somebody else's eyeglasses on. It's not going to give you supervision. It's going to make your vision worse. So if you don't have the symptoms of mental illness, you don't want to be treating it. So in the case of epigenetics, we're referring to a phenomenon where environment is affecting the gene expression, turning those genes on or off inappropriately, thereby giving you the symptoms of mental illness. So what are the environmental factors? A lot of studies out there talking about a history of physical, emotional, or sexual abuse on turning on and off various genes, current life stresses. We ask about this as we see people. What kind of stresses are you going through right now? Coping skills, lifestyle, diet, exercise, smoking can have a big impact on turning those genes on and off. If I could find a medication that could encapsulate the benefits of exercise, it would be a blockbuster. If I can keep people exercising 30 minutes a day, 5-6 days a week, it would be a phenomenal means of cooling down those genetics that shouldn't be getting turned on or off. So exercising can be phenomenal. Having people watch their diet, get them off cigarettes, alcohol, cannabis, other substances will turn those genes on and off. Now, I could talk for a couple hours here about the concerns I have about cannabis, and while we're at it, a little bit of CBD oil, but cannabis is something that's going to wreck our adolescents' future right now. We just have to be very, very careful about these adolescents going out and smoking marijuana because it's horribly damaging to the brain, and that is turning on these genes inappropriately or turning them off inappropriately, causing a lot of mental illness that just wouldn't be there if they didn't use marijuana. Medical illness can turn the genes on or off inappropriately. So what we're doing is we're identifying the symptoms. We're recognizing that there can be stresses and factors in the environment turning these genes on and off, and that's why 32% of our patients are in counseling right now. We actually can track how many people in our practice are in counseling, and we refer people out for counseling. A third of our patients are actively in counseling. The others have been through it before. Maybe they don't need it at this point, but a third of our patients are in counseling to address these factors. So, our genetic testing, as I mentioned, we've done 3,000 patients to date. Here's what we've noticed so far. Number one, the genetic testing does give us dosage guidance. Now, the criticism here is, well, gee, if you see a patient month to month, you can kind of figure out what their dosage should be. If you give them a small dosage of medication, nothing happens, increase the dosage. If you give them the usual dosage of a medication and they're having every side effect in the book, decrease the dosage. I get that, but sometimes it takes you months to figure out. With genetic testing, number one, you could either avoid the medications that they don't metabolize very well, or you could just adjust your dosage on day one accordingly. So dosage guidance has been helpful. Response to SSRIs versus SNRIs, as I mentioned, about 1/4 of our patients have a good genetic profile for an SSRI, a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. These are patients who have an SLC6A4-LALA as a genotype. If they don't have that, you give them something else like an SNRI. The bupropion and vordioxetine responders, that's Wellbutrin and Trintellix. Those are the people who have COMT-VAL-VAL. They might have a mutation at SLC6A4, but we're looking at responders there. We're able to start to sort out who's going to be a good responder to a so-called anti-seizure medication for a mood stabilizer, looking at the calcium and sodium genes. A predictor for stimulants versus atomoxetine, which is also known as Strattera. So are they going to do well on Ritalin or amphetamines, or are they going to do better on Strattera? Well, if they're COMT-VAL-VAL, they do better on stimulants. If they're COMT-MET-MET, they do better on Strattera. That's something we've kind of discovered. Predictor for antipsychotic efficacy, if they have a dopamine 2 gene of CC, they're going to often be a good responder to antipsychotics for mood disturbances. If they have a deletion allele, they're C-delete or deletion, they will be probably a bad candidate for the antipsychotics, and they're going to be at a higher risk for tardive dyskinesia. Tardive dyskinesia is where you have twitches in your face and mouth and tongue. People who have the deletion allele on the dopamine 2 gene are more likely to get tardive dyskinesia, so we can actually predict that. Who needs L-methylfolate and who doesn't? About 1 out of 5 people need L-methylfolate, and you don't know that until you do the genetic testing. We look at the methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase, say that real fast, MTHFR 677 and 1298, two different genes. We put the two of them together and figure out the percentage of how well somebody's breaking down folic acid to L-methylfolate. L-methylfolate is what gets into the brain. So if you think about Lucas Oil Stadium down there where the Colts play, poorly by the way, folic acid is like all the people outside the turnstile, okay? They're trying to get into the stadium. L-methylfolate are like the people in the stadium. Imagine if your turnstiles were sticky and they weren't working so well. You can add more people on the outside, i.e. add more folic acid, and it's not going to help. You got to get them past the turnstiles. So L-methylfolate is like parachuting directly into the brain, the end byproduct of folic acid. Folic acid breaks down to L-methylfolate. If you have a genetic mutation, that can benefit you, and we've seen some people have pretty dramatic effects once they added L-methylfolate. I remember one fella we were considering referring to electroconvulsive treatment, And we put him on L-methylfolate, and he didn't need it, and we still see him, and he's still doing well. So just giving him L-methylfolate prevented him from having ECT. It seems to be a predictor for who's going to do well with alcohol use disorders on a medication called topiramate. And it gives us a choice of alternatives to benzodiazepines. Benzodiazepines are medications like Xanax, Ativan, Valium, Clonopin. We're trying to stay away from those nowadays, simply because they can dull your concentration, you can get used to them. We're just trying to stay away from them. People on benzos don't do as well long-term compared to people off of them. Genetic testing is giving us some other ideas on what they ought to be taking. And long-term, if you get the genetics, you can kind of validate that you're on the right track with somebody, hoping that they won't poop out on the medication, because if they're on the medications that fits their genetics, they're more likely to have successful treatment long-term. So here's the big question. In psychiatry, should we do genetic testing? This is a huge debate right now among psychiatrists, and the American Psychiatric Association recently got to get together a panel, and they kind of said, well, we're not really ready for it yet. So I'm going to give you some pros and cons here. From the arguments not to do genetic testing will be, number one, the cost. The cost can be anywhere to no cost to the patient. If you have commercial insurance, between $25 up to $300 based on your annual income. The cost is something we talk over with a patient, but many times, quite frankly, I have patients coming in asking me to do genetic testing. So if the cost is not an issue, that shouldn't be a factor for them. Another reason not to do it would be it's time consuming for the clinician to sample and process the actual paperwork that needs to be with genetic testing. I'm blessed to have 13 support staff who work with me. A few of them had the kindness to show up tonight. So they do the sampling for me. They get it processed. All I have to do at the end of the day is put it in the FedEx box, and I get the results back within a couple days or a couple weeks. But there is time-consuming for an office to do the sampling and processing. Could you do it at a local lab? Probably, but that's going to be a little bit higher cost for the patient to do that. We try to make it as convenient for the patient as possible. Third, the reason not to do it would be the clinician needs to be able to interpret these results. And that's like a clinician learning a whole new language. I mean, it's like telling a clinician, okay, as of next week, you need to learn Portuguese. Well, that's a lot of stress. Who wants to learn Portuguese? Well, you have to learn how to interpret the code. And we've done a lot of work in putting these wheels together and ways to predict which direction to go if you see different genes. And you don't look at just one gene. You look at a group of them. You look at two and three and four genes together. So you look at a group of genes. It's called epistasis, where you're not looking at one individual gene. You're looking at a group of genes. And that's very important to do that. The insufficient evidence for its usefulness, there's only been about a half dozen studies published worldwide ever on genetic testing in the real world, which is what we're looking at. Hopefully we're going to be another study that can look at that. But insufficient evidence for its usefulness. With a study of a medication, you're going to always have a placebo control. You're going to give people a sugar pill, and then you're going to give another group of people the real medication, and you're going to figure out, do the people on the real medication do better than the sugar pill? It's called a placebo-controlled trial. How do you do that with genetic testing? I talked about a month ago to one of the world's experts on genetic testing, and he's out of University of Melbourne in Australia. And he said, it's tough to do, because do you give some people fake genetics and see how they do with treatment as usual, and then give another group the real genetics and then figure out who's going to do better? It's tough to do. So the criticism is always going to be, well, they're doing better because they know you're treating them based on their genetics. So it's a placebo effect where if you treat somebody based on their genetics, they're going to do better. Well, I think there's more to it than that, because placebo effects usually last no more than 6 or 8 weeks, and then they tend to fade. That's what we see with medication trials. With genetics, we're seeing long-term benefits in using genetic testing. The cookbook algorithm is not helpful in achieving favorable outcomes, and I agree. Some genetic testing companies, not the one we use, but some genetic testing companies said, okay, clinicians, we want to make this easy for you. Here's the medications you use if they have certain genetic testing results. It doesn't work that way. You've got to look at the other four points of the star. You've got to look at their individual symptoms. You've got to look at their family histories, their past treatment responses. You've got to look at their treatment goals and their side effects they want to avoid. You put all those 5 points of the star together, and then you add the genetic testing on top of that, looking at your individual genes, and you put that together. But sometimes the genetic testing companies have put these cookbooks together saying, if you have these genetics, take this medication. And then clinicians try that, and they say, that doesn't work, and then they give up on it. And that's what the American Psychiatric Association examined. They examined companies that gave the cookbooks out like that, and they said, well, they don't seem to be working, so it's not ready for psychiatry yet. Here's the reasons to do it, and I'm going to list them in order. If for no other reason to do it, it just gives you that added dimension to treatment choice. It's not hurting. It just gives you that added clue on how their hardware is designed for that unique individual. Secondly, it's not going to mislead you on treatment choices. I have yet to see somebody get worse based on our treating them on their genetics. I mean, sometimes people don't respond real well no matter what you give them, but I don't see people getting worse because of a decision we made on genetic testing. Now, what I have seen thousands of times in my career will be somebody who just randomly gets a medication, then they get a lot worse. We've seen that for years with the so-called SSRIs, and retrospectively, these are the very people who are the people who have the SLC6A4 mutations of LG or S's on their alleles. So, yeah, if you guess, you might get worsening of the treatment responses. Third, it's important to understand a person's metabolism of various medications. Different medications go through different enzymes. It's like going to the local Meijer grocery store, and you've got checkout lane 1 through 20, okay? You've got to check out through checkout lane 6. That's the only checkout you can go through, but there's a big line there. So how do you get through checkout line 6 faster? You have less stuff. So if you have a enzyme that's a slow enzyme for you, and you're using other medications that go through that enzyme too, guess what? You take a lower dose. So that's called poor metabolism or intermittent metabolism, where we use a lower dosage for people who have metabolic deficiencies with certain pathways, if that's a good medication for them. Now, some of the cookbook algorithms out there will say, don't use that medication. Well, you want to use that medication if it's a good medication for how their brain works. So it might not be great from a pharmacokinetic standpoint. Okay, I get that. Take a lower dosage. But if it's a good medication from a pharmacodynamic standpoint, it's a medication that's going to help them with depression. You want to use that medication, but just at a lower dosage. So you have to take that all in consideration. You want a medication that works, and you want to give it at the right dosage, whether it be a low dosage, a usual dosage, or a high dosage. Genotyping never changes. Your genetics are going to be the same for the rest of your life. So we always, always, always give our patients the genetic testing results. And if you ever get genetic testing, ask for the results. Those are yours. That's you. They will never change. 10 years from now, we're going to be a lot smarter. God willing, I'll still be around working at that time. But 10 years from now, we're going to be a lot smarter on these genetic testing. We can use the genetic testing on you 10 years from now because it never changes. Sometimes people ask me, when I get better, will my genetics change? No. The switch might get turned on or off in a normal fashion, but the actual genetic, the coding never changes. And that's something we can always use. MTHFR mutation. Do you need L-methylfolate or not? Generally, if somebody's breaking down less than 50% of their folic acid to L-methylfolate, I recommend they get supplementation with L-methylfolate, either through the internet. You can get it sometimes by prescription. Insurances aren't yet covering it a lot of times. But through the internet, L-methylfolate costs about $61 for a 90-day supply. It's not horribly expensive, but if you need it, you'd need it. And it's worth taking it if you're having some symptoms. You know, we look at the SLC6A4 genotype that predicts how well somebody's going to do on the serotonin transporter medications, like the SSRIs, and that can be a predictor. Do you use them or not use them? COMT genotype refers to dopamine processing, so we know whether we should use higher or lower dosages there. BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor genotype, can predict if you're going to be a good responder to exercise. Now, I love to recommend 30 minutes of exercise to everybody for 5-6 days a week. But if you have a brain-derived neurotrophic factor MET allele from your mom and or your dad, you can do particularly well with exercise. So for those people, they're genetically prone to do well with exercise very specifically. So as we put the personalized algorithm for treatment together, we look at the systematic diagnostic assessment. We look at the family history of treatment responses, past psychiatric medication history, and get the mechanism of action all put together. We look at the patient goals and the side effects to be avoided. But it's the fifth dimension. You don't want to just look at somebody's genetic testing, not interview them, not look at their past treatment responses, not look at their family history, not talk to them about their goals and treatment side effects they want to avoid. You add the genetic testing after you consider all those other factors in the algorithm itself. Right now, with adolescents, there's two antidepressants, for instance, that are FDA approved for depression for adolescents, Lexapro and Prozac. Well, guess what? They both are serotonin transporter inhibitors. So if they're one of the one out of four people who have good genetics for that particular transporter, great, but three out of four people don't. So that's why historically we've seen a lot of adolescents not do so well on that category as medication. I'll be hanging around during break. You're going to get a break here. Tammy, you want to come back up and tell them where they're going to go from here? But thank you very much.